One of the most famous sound chips of the 80s is undoubtedly the MOS6581 sound interface device, or SID for short. The SID was mainly used in the Commodore 64 and 128, but also in the lesser known Commodore CPM2 and Max machine. In this video I will put one of these on a breadboard and try to get some sounds out of it. Stay tuned. A SID alone is useless, of course. We need to add a microcontroller. I chose an ESP32S2 board here because it has enough I/O pins to drive all the digital inputs the SID has. And its applications can be easily controlled over VLAN. So I can easily operate it from a small HTML page that I made for this purpose. This gives us easy access to the 29 registers of the SID. Just set the desired value and the page calculates the register contents, sends it to the ESP, and the ESP immediately writes it into the corresponding register. But first we need to connect the 5 address pins, the 4 control signals, and the 8 data lines. But hold on, I just remembered that the IOs of the ESP are rated for 3.3 volt, while those of the SID are designed for 5 volt TDL levels. According to the datasheet, the SID detects input voltages above 2 volts as high level. So the output pins of the ESP can be connected directly to the input pins of the SID chip. However, if you read data from the SID, the data lines function as 5 volt TTL outputs and could potentially overload the 3.3 volt input pins. There the data sheet says that the output voltage lies between 2.4 and 4.3 volts. Nevertheless, I took the risk and connected the data lines directly. Besides the usual 5 volt, the SID also needs a second supply voltage of 12 volt. I get the 12 volts directly from my bench power supply, and from that I derive the 5 volts through a linear power regulator. Finally, I put in the filter capacitors of 2.2 nanofarads each. And here's the schematic, which you can also find on GitHub. The link is in the description. Do you already plan to recreate this project but need something more durable than a breadboard? Then I recommend you to build it on a PCB from PCBWay. Upload your design files to their website and configure your boards online. The boards are of the best quality and highly reliable. That's why PCBWay is my preferred PCB supplier. Soldering is done in no time and it is a real fun, so check it out. Now I'm ready to hook up an oscilloscope probe to the output pin, also the microphone input of my computer, so I can see and record what's going on. The last thing we need is a 12 volt supply voltage. Then I open the website from the ESP32. The SID has 3 independent sound generators that can output a wide range of frequencies up to nearly 4000 Hz. Each of these can produce 4 different waveforms. A rectangular wave with a variable duty cycle. This produces a hard, brassy sound. A sawtooth, which sounds like a string instrument. And a triangle for soft, flute-like sounds. And noise for percussion and other sound effects. On the web interface, we can switch between these 3 voices and change their individual settings. Toggling the gate bit turns each voice on or off. The selected oscillators simply add up, and in this way we can compose chords. The ring 3 bit multiplies a rectangle wave from oscillator 3 with a waveform from oscillator 1. In other words, the oscillator 1 wave is amplitude modulated to the oscillator 3 frequency. Looks nice on the scope, but sounds terrible. However, the ring modulation does not work with a rectangle or sawtooth wave. Voice 1 wave must always be a triangle. Also, the voice 3 carrier wave is always rectangular, no matter how it's configured. The sync bit locks the frequency of voice 1 to the frequency of voice 3. This allows waveforms to be combined, such as a rectangle from voice 3 with a triangle from voice 1. Here I lock a rectangle with a sawtooth. Or just 2 rectangles. Now see and hear the difference when the waves are out of sync and in sync. What makes a SID a true synthesizer are the ADSR envelopes. A stands for attack. This is the phase in which the sound is built up. In the D or decay phase, the volume decreases until it reaches a sustain level. And in the release phase, the sound finally fades away. We can set all these values in the web interface. Attack, decay and sustain happen during the gate time or while the gate bit is set. And resetting the gate bit triggers a release phase. By this way, the chip can synthesize all kind of instrument or sound effect. And that's still not all. Remember the two capacitors I put in earlier? Those are needed by the filter. I'm going to show its impact on a square wave now. The filter can be activated with these checkboxes for each of the three voices. So I have a high pass for voice 1. Let's play with its cutoff frequency. Now I try the band pass. And of course, the low pass. And with that resonance slider, we can emphasize these overshoots. By the way, I made all the sound effects in this video with a SID. And the SID can do more than just produce noises. It also has two analog inputs for connecting up to four pedals. A pedal is basically a potentiometer with a capacitor in series. Multiplexing between the two inputs and the pedals is done by a 4066 analog switch. And here's how the conversion works. The analog registers contain the time it takes to charge the capacitor to a certain level. This is proportional to the series resistance, so these analog inputs are ohmmeters rather than classical ADCs. The next register contains the current value of the voice 3 output. We can see this well if we set the voice 3 to 1 Hz and rectangle as waveform. Then I start the polling and see the register value jump between 0 and 255, or close to it. When the sawtooth is selected, we see that its value repeatedly rises and then falls back. With noise set as a waveform, the register can be used as a randomizer. And the last one contains the current gain as determined by the ADSR envelope. Watch its value while I'm playing through the ADSR phases. By feeding the contents of the waveform register back into the frequency registers via software, we get vibrato sound effects. I'm decreasing the frequency of voice 3, so you can hear it more clearly. With voice 3 set to rectangle, we hear two alternating tones. And sawtooth or triangle results into siren-like sound effects. By feeding back the envelope register, we can achieve Doppler effects. Let's alter the intensity of the effect. And so it sounds without the feedback. And again, with maximum feedback for comparison. The MOS6581 has a bug. If you change the main volume, the DC bias voltage of the audio output also changes. Clever programmers exploited this fact and misused the SID as a 4-bit DA converter. This way, sound samples could be played. And this is how the speech output of some legendary games works. Another visitor. Stay a while. Stay forever. However, this bug was fixed in the later 6580 and 6582 versions, so the speech synthesis didn't work anymore. No! Nifty guys, however, came up with the idea of putting a resistor between the filter pins. This fix of the bug fix became known as the DigiFix. That's it for now. Check out the other videos on my channel. Subscribe and enable notifications to stay up to date. Also consider becoming a Patreon or channel member and get ad-free previews and other goodies. See you next time.